What's going on, guys? No offense to NFL players, but if fans of your own team hate you, and you probably did quite a bit to warrant that hate, Colts fans still loved Peyton Manning when he left Indy for Denver, and 49ers fans never stopped loving Joe Montana. But some players left behind some sour memories with their old teams, and others had ugly departures. Because of this, some of these players are still despised by the fan bases of the very teams they played for. Every NFL team has that one guy their fans still despise, whether they are still in the league or retired for decades. These players have learned that some fans simply don't forgive and never forget. So without further ado, here's a look at every NFL team's former player that their own fans hate. Make sure to subscribe to TPS, put on your notifications too. We post videos all the time. Subscribe. Arizona Cardinals, Conrad Dobler. The three-time Pro Bowl guard played with the St. Louis Cardinals from 1972 to 77. But he was quite despised among peers and fans for being an extremely dirty player. Some even accused him of trying to hurt people on the field. In fact, Sports Illustrated once said he was the dirtiest player in football. With that, some Cardinals fans had a tough time supporting the guy. Atlanta Falcons, Michael Vick. The Falcons drafted Vick first overall in 2001, and he quickly emerged as the new face of the franchise. Vick took over games with his never-before-seen mobility and speed as quarterback. He was a three-time Pro Bowler in Atlanta, and he even led the team to the 2004 NFC Championship game. But in 2007, investigators discovered that Vick was running an illegal dog ring in Surrey County. Vick was handed a 23-month prison sentence, thus ending his career with the Falcons. He returned to the NFL in 2009, joining the Philadelphia Eagles, but the damage had been done. Vick won from hero to zero in Atlanta. Baltimore Ravens, Joe Flacco. It's impossible to understand how fans could hate on a Super Bowl champion and MVP, but it all came down to what have you done for me lately? Joe Flacco led the Ravens to the playoffs in each of his first 5 years, including three AFC Championship games. Finally, Flacco led Baltimore to a Super Bowl 47 championship victory over the San Francisco 49ers. He was named the Big Games MVP too, but Flacco never regained that magic again. His performance declined mightily from there, and the Ravens only made the playoffs once over the next 5 years. Fans often booed Flacco and kept calling for change during this time frame. Injuries and poor production led to Flacco losing his starting job to rookie Lamar Jackson in 2018. Flacco was traded to the Denver Broncos, ending a decade-long complicated relationship with the Ravens faithful. Now that being said though, if he ever came back after he retired, I'm sure they'd cheer for him. I mean, he won them a Super Bowl, so you gotta have some respect for the guy. Buffalo Bills, Sean Merriman. Buffalo landed the Pro Bowl linebacker in 2010, but he had a complicated relationship with the Bills Mafia. He struggled to stay healthy, landing on season-ending IR in each of his first two seasons in Buffalo. And when he was on the field, he wasn't the same Pro Bowl talent we saw in San Diego. His dirty and aggressive style of play rubbed plenty of people the wrong way as well. So with that, he didn't really command much love from the Bills fan base. Carolina Panthers, Ray Carruth. The Panthers had hoped that the Colorado product would be a big part of their offense, having drafted him in the first round in 97, but he threw all that away. One of Ray's friends shot Cherica Adams, who was pregnant with his child. On November 16, 1997, Adams was able to call 911 and told them what had happened, saying that Ray blocked her vehicle before she was shot. Adams later succumbed to her wounds, though doctors were able to deliver the baby. Ray was handed an 18 to 24 year prison sentence for conspiracy to commit murder. He was released from prison in 2018. It's hard for anybody to like this guy again. Just a horrible and sickening act. Chicago Bears, Jay Cutler. The Bears acquired Cutler in a trade with the Denver Broncos back in 2009, but despite some good showings here and there during his 8-year run in the Windy City, Cutler was strongly disliked by his own fan base. Cutler suffered an MCL sprain during Chicago's 2010 NFC Championship home loss to Green Bay, and many Bears fans accused him of quitting on the team. Fans also criticized Cutler for seemingly not caring whenever the Bears lost. Oh, and that 7-year, $126 million deal they handed him wound up being quite the disaster. Cincinnati Bengals, Vontaze Burfict. One of the most universally disliked players in NFL history, Burfict was especially unpopular among his own fans in Cincinnati. I mean, his headshot on Antonio Brown in the 2015 wildcard game cost the Bengals their first playoff win since 1990. Burfict racked up many careless penalties during Bengals games as well. He couldn't stay out of trouble, receiving fines and suspensions left, right, and center. Absolutely no idea how the Bengals kept him around for 7 years. Cleveland Browns, Johnny Manziel. Ah, Johnny Football, what a classic. The Browns drafted the 2012 Heisman Trophy winner with the 22nd pick in 2014. Manziel had a high bust potential, but Cleveland believed the risk was worth the potential rewards. Nope, not even close. Manziel's tenure in Cleveland was a mess from the get-go. He broke curfew, was caught partying off the field, and never took the playbook or anything football-related seriously. And of course, Manziel performed poorly when he was on the field. Manziel was released by the Browns in 2016. These long-suffering fans couldn't forgive a guy that wound up being a complete waste of a first-round pick. Dallas Cowboys, Tony Romo. Romo rescued the Cowboys in the midst of the 2016 2006 season, leading them to a wild card spot. In all, Romo was a four-time Pro Bowler who led Dallas to the postseason four times in his career. But Romo was strongly disliked by a large portion of Cowboys fan base. He won just two of six playoff games in his career. He made numerous late game gaffes that cost the Cowboys, including a botched snap on a go-ahead field goal chance in the 2006 wild card game against Seattle. Romo was simply a major underachiever in the big games. Rookie Dak Prescott took over as the starter in 2016 following an injury to Romo, and Tony retired in the 2017 offseason before joining the CBS broadcast booth. I'm not saying they hate him, but strongly dislike would definitely be up there. I still think he could come back and be a coach, but that's just me. Denver Broncos, Bill Romanowski. The Pro Bowl linebacker won four Super Bowls throughout his career, two with San Francisco and two with the Broncos. But Romanowski was simply one of the game's dirtiest players in history, and it made him largely unpopular across the NFL. Many Broncos fans had a tough time cheering for a guy who crossed the line time and time again. He broke Kerry Collins' jaw in a 1997 preseason contest with a dirty hit. He spat in the face of J.J. Stokes as well. There was another incident where he punched the beloved and admired Kansas City Chiefs Pro Bowl tight end Tony Gonzalez. Romanowski was just a giant pain in the ass. Wherever he went, a lot of his fans seemed to turn on him. Detroit Lions, Charles Rogers. The Lions drafted the Michigan State wideout with the number two pick in 2003. But Rogers didn't end up being a franchise star they had hoped for. Injuries and suspensions for violating the NFL substance abuse policy led to a disappointing NFL career for Rogers. Lions fans had a tough time forgiving the guy who costed them a second overall pick but simply couldn't produce on the field. He was released in 2006 and never played in the NFL again. Sadly, Rogers passed away in November 2019 due to liver failure. He previously had been diagnosed with cancer and was in need of a liver transplant. I can't help but assume that many Lions fans have since forgiven Rogers as a result of the untimely passing. Green Bay Packers, Tony Mandarich. The Packers drafted the Michigan State offensive lineman with the number two pick in the star-studded 1989 class. Sports Illustrated even called Mandarich the best offensive line prospect ever. Well, Mandarich's big mouth and arrogant attitude quickly made him unpopular in Green Bay. He had a lengthy contract holdout ahead of his rookie year. Mandarich also performed poorly for the Packers and was released after the 92 season, cementing his legacy as one of the NFL's biggest draft busts, as well as the most hated player in Packers history according to fellow cheeseheads. Houston Texans, Brock Osweiler. After winning a Super Bowl 50 championship in Denver as Peyton Manning's backup, Brock Osweiler signed a four-year, $72 million deal with the Houston Texans. But Osweiler was downright terrible in Houston. He had 15 touchdowns against 16 interceptions while completing just 59% of his passes. Osweiler was so bad that Houston gave the Cleveland Browns a second-round pick just to take on his contract. On the bright side, Osweiler's horrible play led to Houston trading up so they could draft Deshaun Watson in 2017, so that worked out nicely for them. Indianapolis Colts, Bart Schlichter. The Baltimore Colts drafted Schlichter with the number four pick in 1982, but his gambling addiction led to an extremely disappointing career. For example, Schlichter's entire $350,000 signing bonus was gone before the end of his rookie year. Schlichter continued to lose hundreds of thousands of dollars betting on sporting events. This led to a suspension from the NFL, and the Colts cut ties with him during the 1985 campaign. Schlichter simply threw away his own career when the Colts spent a high-end pick in hopes of turning him into a star. Hard for Colts fans to forgive him for that. Jacksonville Jaguars, Jalen Ramsey. Ramsey was a cornerstone of the Jaguars for 3 years from 2016 to 18, and he led them to the 2017 AFC Championship game. However, Ramsey's relationship with Jaguars coaches and management began to fracture in 2019. He was seen arguing with head coach Doug Marrone during a game on the sidelines, which players had to break up. Ramsey became such a problem for the Jaguars that they finally gave up, and he was sent to the Los Angeles Rams in a 2019 midseason blockbuster. Hard for Jaguars fans to look back gracefully on Ramsey's tenure now. He was supposed to be the future of this franchise, but Ramsey put himself ahead of the team far too often. Kansas City Chiefs, Larry Johnson. Johnson was a two-time Pro Bowl running back for the Kansas City Chiefs, earning a first-team All-Pro selection in 2006, leading the club to a wild-card playoff berth in the process. But Johnson quickly became unpopular around the NFL, and especially within KC, when he used homophobic slurs in an interview during the 2009 season. Kansas City suspended Johnson, and Chiefs fans later ran a petition that demanded the team cut him for his comments. The petition read that Johnson has never represented anything close to the values that we have for our Chiefs. The fans got their wish, and he was eventually released. Los Angeles Chargers, Ryan Leaf. The Chargers drafted Leaf second overall in 98, right after the Colts took Peyton Manning. Both were considered can't-miss prospects, although that turned out to be the case for only one of them. Leaf's NFL career was a mess from the get-go. He played golf instead of studying game film, and was a giant problem in the locker room. Leaf had a hot temper and clashed with the media. Teammate Rodney Harrison said it was a nightmare with Leaf in 1998, and other players demanded the team bring in another quarterback. Leaf was released by the Chargers in 2001, leaving behind nothing but unhappy memories with the team. Los Angeles Rams, Lawrence Phillips. Rams had a rising superstar at running back in Jerome Bettis, but the team became enamored with Nebraska product Lawrence Phillips. This was despite Phillips brutally assaulting his ex-girlfriend at college. He had numerous incidents before the 96 draft, but the Rams just didn't care. So the Rams traded Bettis to the Steelers in a trade that went down as one of the most one-sided in history. Then they drafted Phillips sixth overall, but his poor play and attitude problems led to the Rams releasing him in 97. It was hard for Rams fans to like this Phillips guy to begin with. The fact that he failed as Bettis' successor made him even more unpopular in LA. Phillips died in prison in 2016. Miami Dolphins, Richie Incognito. Hard for Dolphins fans to ever look back fondly on a guy who bullied, harassed, and threatened teammate Jonathan Martin during the 2013 season. Incognito embarrassed the entire Miami organization with his sickening behavior, and it led to the Dolphins suspending him. Really, how could any Dolphins fan stand by this guy after what he did to Martin and the organization's reputation? Minnesota Vikings, Matt Khalil. Aside from a Pro Bowl selection in his rookie year, he didn't live up to expectations as the number 4 pick in 2012. The Vikings moved on from him after 5 seasons. After signing with the Carolina Panthers in 2017, he took a shot at his former team. He was quoted saying the following: "The first guy I've played for that kind of demands excellence from his offensive line room. Tell us how you really feel, Matt. Because I could tell you how most Vikings fans feel right about now. That is, they probably don't like you very much anymore." New England Patriots, Aaron Hernandez. Rob Gronkowski and Aaron Hernandez formed the popular Boston tight end party. But this dynamic duo only lasted 3 years together. Hernandez sadly threw away his career in the 2013 offseason, when he was arrested for the murder of Odin Lloyd. The latter was dating the sister of Hernandez's fiance. 2 years later, Hernandez was found guilty and convicted, receiving a life prison sentence. Hernandez had also been indicted for a 2012 double murder that happened in Boston, but he was later acquitted. Hernandez committed suicide in prison 2 years after he was convicted. New Orleans Saints, Reggie Bush. The Saints drafted the stud USC running back with the number 2 pick in 2006. Now, Bush wasn't terrible by any means, but he certainly didn't live up to the sky-high expectations either. I mean, the guy was on their Super Bowl 44 championship team, but many New Orleans fans remain unhappy about his inability to reach full expectations. And the infamous USC scandal in which he received unauthorized gifts while in college that forced Bush to relinquish the Heisman Trophy. That didn't sit well with many Saints fans either. New York Giants, Odell Beckham Jr. OBJ is one of those players that you love if he's on your team. And if he's not on your team, well, you love to hate him. With all that being said, Beckham is no longer with the Giants, so it's probably easy for the fans in the Meadowlands to hate on this guy. Don't get me wrong, he gave them some good moments, but Beckham had some behavior issues during his time with the G-Men, often throwing temper tantrums on the sidelines. But the Giants and their fans put up with it, since he was a dynamic game changer for their offense. But then Beckham got traded to the Cleveland Browns in the 2019 offseason, and OBJ has since criticized the Giants organization numerous times. We're sure New York football fans aren't missing this guy all that much. New York Jets, Mark Sanchez. Once hyped as the Sanchez, Mark Sanchez's tenure in New York got off to a promising start. He was able to lead the team to the AFC Championship game in each of his first 2 years. This included road playoff wins against Pro Bowl quarterbacks like Carson Palmer, Phillip Rivers, Peyton Manning, and Tom Brady. But Sanchez was never a very good quarterback himself. He couldn't take over games, and the guy turned the ball over way too many times. His tenure with the Jets was summed up best by his infamous butt fumble. Sanchez was booed heavily by Jets fans, and Rex Ryan received a ton of criticism for being loyal to him for 4 years. New York finally released him in the 2014 offseason. Oakland Raiders, Antonio Brown. Not really a surprise here. The Raiders acquired the all-pro receiver from the Pittsburgh Steelers in a 2019 offseason blockbuster trade, but it only took a few months for Brown to stir the pot even worse in Oakland than he did in Pittsburgh. Brown threatened to retire because the NFL wouldn't let him wear his preferred helmet. Brown also got into a scuffle with general manager Mike Mayock and called him a racial slur. Finally, John Gruden and the Raiders gave up and cut Brown before the start of the 2019 season. And so the Raiders got nothing out of Brown after giving up 3rd and 5th round picks for his services. It soon became evident that Brown had purposely forced his way out of Oakland, just so he can join the Patriots shortly after his release. Given his behavior and the way he forced his way out, it's safe to say that the Raiders fans and pretty much all NFL fans, I mean, maybe not Patriots fans, but they probably don't like him now, are going to hate this guy for a long, long time. Philadelphia Eagles, Terrell Owens. The Hall of Fame Pro Bowler had quite the storied 2-year tenure in Philly. Owens arrived via trade in 2004, and he helped Philadelphia reach Super Bowl 39, where they fell to the Patriots. In 2005, Owens began clashing with Eagles management, coaches, and players, even calling out quarterback Donovan McNabb. Owens was suspended by the Eagles, and they cut him in 2006. He signed with the arch-rival Cowboys, making Owens public enemy number one in Philadelphia. To this day, most Eagles fans don't seem to remember Owens fondly. Rather than thinking of him as the dude who played through injury and almost led them to a Super Bowl win, Eagles fans think of T.O. as a traitor and troublemaker instead. Pittsburgh Steelers, James Harrison. One of the greatest undrafted players ever, Harrison was a five-time Pro Bowler, the 2008 Defensive Player of the Year, and a two-time Super Bowl champion with the Steelers. He'll forever be remembered for his 100-yard pick six at the end of the first half in Super Bowl 43. After momentarily retiring in 2014, Harrison returned to the Steelers and continued to be a backbone on their defense, but he wasn't happy with a reduced role during the 2017 season, so he asked and received his release. Harrison then signed with the rival Patriots and helped them reach Super Bowl 52, much to the disgust of Pittsburgh fans. Harrison criticized the Steelers and said he didn't come back to win a participation trophy and to be a cheerleader. He has since called out Mike Tomlin numerous times as well. And so Harrison's relationship with the Steelers went from sweet to very, very sour. San Francisco 49ers, Charles Haley. Haley was a cornerstone of two San Francisco 49ers Super Bowl championship teams, but the Pro Bowl linebacker and defensive end had a major attitude problem, so their head coach sent him to the Cowboys in a 1992 blockbuster trade. This marked the start of an epic 49ers-Cowboys rivalry that dominated the 90s. Haley became one of the final pieces of the championship puzzle in Dallas. He won three Super Bowls with the Cowboys, and Haley's squad defeated San Francisco in the 1992 and 93 NFC Championship games. For 49ers fans, those two losses soured all the nice memories Haley had created on the West Coast a few years earlier. Seattle Seahawks, Richard Sherman. He was an instrumental part of the Seattle Legion of Boom defense that dominated the NFL for a half decade. Sherman was instrumental in helping the Seahawks win Super Bowl 48, and they nearly won a second Lombardi Trophy a year later. But Sherman's age, coupled with history, led to Seattle releasing him in 2018. The Pro Bowl corner signed with the arch-rival San Francisco 49ers, and he said the Seahawks lost their way several months later. In 2018, Sherman said the Seahawks were a middle-of-the-road team. Sherman also called out Russell Wilson, saying he's seen the guy throw five picks in a game, and that he doesn't have much of a relationship with his former quarterback. Did we mention that Sherman joined the arch-rival 49ers? Yeah, this guy is now public enemy number one in Seattle. Tampa Bay Buccaneers, Gerald McCoy. McCoy was a six-time Pro Bowler and among the few bright spots on a miserable Tampa team. However, he was released by the team during the 2019 offseason after refusing to take a pay cut. McCoy then signed with the NFC South rival Panthers, thus making him a top enemy in Tampa. McCoy criticized the organization for their lack of communication during the offseason and for giving away his number immediately after he left the team. He even encouraged Tampa fans to boo him when he returned. So, point taken. Tennessee Titans, Adam Pac-Man Jones. Renowned for his terrific special teams return skills, Pac-Man Jones should have been a fan favorite in the Music City. Jones had a big year for the Titans in 2006, but his off-the-field issues and locker room problems became too much. He received a one-year suspension for violating the NFL's player conduct policy. Jones was also reportedly involved in a 2007 Las Vegas shooting incident. With so many legal troubles, the Titans gave up and traded him to the Dallas Cowboys in 2008. Jones could have been a perennial fan favorite in Tennessee, but he wouldn't let that happen. Washington Redskins, Albert Haynesworth. The Redskins handed the two-time Pro Bowl defensive tackle a seven-year pact worth $100 million in the 2009 offseason. But Haynesworth was a disaster in DC from the get-go. He was out of shape after joining the team, and he called out the team's defensive system early in the season. He also made headlines by simply not trying at all on this play during a Monday night game. The Redskins suspended Haynesworth in 2010 for what was reportedly deemed conduct detrimental to the team. Washington ended the toxicity by trading him to the Patriots in 2011. But even Bill Belichick was unable to revive his career. Haynesworth was out of the NFL by 2012. What other former players from your favorite teams do you dislike to this day? Join me in the comment section below. Make sure to follow myself and TPS on social media. We post great content all the time. TikTok, Instagram, Twitter, YouTube, the whole thing. Go subscribe and like. And also subscribe to TPS right down below because that red button down there needs to be clicked. And if you don't click it, then that's 1,000 years of bad luck. I'm just kidding. I hate when people do that. Just subscribe, please. Like this video if you liked it. It takes one click. Of course, thank you so much for watching. I'm Jason Biondo. I'll see you next time. My name.